All right, 2019, 2020 COVID pandemic-induced liquid fuel engine or LFE capstone. The floor is yours.
Well, thanks. I mean, this might be dumb, but maybe we can start this by actually, I can just share my screen. I can show you we tried to clean up our class and sort of capstone work, so I could sort of walk through what we've got in the just in the folder tree now. That might be helpful when folks try to find stuff, and then we can move into let's see. Saul, would you be able to show some CAD after that? And then we can talk maybe a little bit of, I can talk some of the CFD and we can do questions and recommendations.
I don't think Saul's back yet.
Oh,
He's
he
said he
hasn't.
was switching computers.
Yeah, he's probably switching back over to Windows. Okay, well, I'll get started then. Let's assume he said yes.
This is great. Again, just for some context, remember what this is for is for people coming on board the LFE project. And
Yeah,
so
okay, cool.
it's just a big introduction. Assume we don't know anything and assume that who's ever listening doesn't know anything. So you're bringing them up from zero.
Okay, no problem. Am I sharing a screen? I can't tell. The green
Are.
box didn't
I
appear.
can
Okay,
see
great.
the screen.
Do you see a screen with a folder tree?
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. For whatever reason, the green outline is not appearing, but that's fine. Oh, Saul, what I was saying is I assume you just switched over to Windows, maybe. Would you be willing to do some CAD in a little bit?
That's correct. I went to Windows. Sure, we can look through it.
Okay, sounds good. So we put our work in the 2019 2020. This is PSAS LFETS 2019 2020 LFE LFETS capstone. Yes, that means LFE is now also under LFETS. I'm sorry. We've tried to organize and
There's a reason.
yeah, well, there are many reasons, some of them better than others. So yeah, let me just, I guess, just walk through here. Hopefully this will be useful. I know one of the things that was a struggle for us when we came in was just figuring out like where stuff was located. So if you would like to look through our meeting notes, you're more than welcome to. They're all located under meeting notes. It's kind of just a big running list, sort of similar to PSAS general style. If we look under liquid fuel engine, we have, let's see, here's a few guidelines from i3D specifically about how to design as well as some specs for their different powders. We tried to export some of our conversations with manufacturers. Hopefully that can help this be a little more unbroken.
That's great.
Yeah, in the case where like I don't know, I can't find an email or it was never sent to me or whatever. So hopefully you should be able to find qu all of our quotes there and anything else that we talked to a manufacturer about. This is sort of a preliminary folder. I think maybe this could be built out in the future if it becomes useful. This has just sort of some of our basic parameters, some of our like design review notes, as well as just some sort of very early hand calcs. Okay, so what we've got here is here's some of the CFD work that we did for the fuel injector, in addition to a bunch of pretty CFD images, which, you know, always look very nice. Yeah, lots of CFD images. I would say what's probably more beneficial here is the raw. This is for STAR CCM. These are the STAR CCM files that were used in, that are referenced in our final report, which we haven't quite got to yet, but you're welcome to read if you'd like. We also produced a video, which is here as well in a moment. But if you have STAR CCM running or you have access to the engineering building, anyway, you have a license key, you can open these and take a look at what we've done. This was actually work that I did for a class over winter term, but it was PSAS related, so it's also here. And this was, so what I've put up here is one of the projects in the class was to create a tutorial of how to do something in STAR. So the tutorial I create was how to do, I created was how to do transient, both conjugate heat transfer, so heat transfer from one material to another, and then also how to do a transient model in STAR. So it's not a very fancy model. It's just hot gas in a pipe, but that's kind of what a rocket is. So it was pretty relevant. And if you're trying to learn, this may, I would say concepts are probably going to be similar to other programs, but I've only used STAR, so I can't really comment on exactly how that's going to work. And then the other thing we've got here is the other project I did for that class specifically was modeling heat transfers. Sorry, I'm scrolling quickly, looking for a picture. Modeling heat transfer through the engine wall. Also includes sim files, so that's the STAR files for both. I think the difference, aluminum and then stainless steel, as well as the part that was used. I don't remember what's in here. Oh, so this, we did part of this organization for our class. So assuming no one had any idea. So what we've got here is just a link to GitHub where the actual CAD is stored. And then a couple other miscellaneous resources. I think the other super relevant thing to talk about at the moment, this is a little bit buried, but under all the class reports we worked on, 493, so that's the spring term, we have both our project poster available, if you'd like to check it out. We have our final report, which you're also definitely welcome to check out. It's got most of what I just talked about, as well as some more detailed conversation about the design work. And then if you're, I think, I don't actually know which one is our final one. If not, I'll make sure we get the final copy up here. But we also have a presentation, which I...
5 would be the most recent up there.
Wow, this one says 7.
Never mind.
Oh, well, it is most recent, though. Okay, no, 7. Okay. I'll upload the final one as well. I'll just pull it off of the other website where it got posted for the rest of the class. But we also have our video that we produced sort of in lieu of what would normally be the poster presentation period. So that's pretty good. It's about 45 minutes long, so feel free to skip around if you do watch it. And it's got both like some slideshow as well as a bunch of like talking about CAD.
Would you recommend that people watch that 45-minute video first before they watch this video?
I'm sorry, can you ask that more time?
Yeah, do you recommend that people watch that 45-minute presentation before they watch our discussion?
I think...
It's edited better.
It's probably edited better. I think maybe, so there's sections in this, so it, I guess, depends what you want to get out of it. The video also talks, is both, it, like, the first half is LFE, the second half is LFETs, so it's kind of a 20-minute video for each,
yeah,
plus, okay, like, 5 to 10 minutes of, like, sort of talk about the project and, like, the project goals and the project scope and that sort of thing, so, yeah, I think it's great to watch.
Where the files are, which GitHub repository you need, or anything like that.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't go into any of that. Sure. So
it's a good. Sounds like that's a good first thing for people to do, is to go ahead and watch that video, and then they can watch this video and get into it. Okay.
I hope so. Yeah. Yeah. Well,
if you don't like that video, you're really not going to like this.
We also have, in addition to that, we've part of the senior ME curriculum are these ME 411 measurements classes. So we did one which included the Pintle water testing as well as load cell testing. So those reports are both here, as well as, oh, I think just a link to the project folder for the flow testing. Let's see, we've linked to all the procedures that we wrote, although those for PSAS purposes, those are also, this. I think these are just links. Yeah, these are just links to the test fire procedures. So if you forget where they're located on the PSAS drive, you can also find them through this route. We've got some miscellaneous resources in here. We have a better link now, but this is the Modern Engineering for Design of Liquid Propellant Rocket Engines is a great textbook. I think this is individual chapters because that's all I was able to download from the library, from the PDX library. But there is a full form somewhere, which I don't quite recall. We also have some other resources in here. We've got a copy of the UC San Diego test stand design. Flow calculator for generant, which is relief valve sizing. Oh, here's the same thing. Okay, here's the same book, but in PDF, single PDF form. Don't know what this one is. Rocket Propulsion Elements is another good reference textbook, I would say, for us in terms of liquid fuel engine. The two reference books are Rocket Propulsion Elements and Huzel and Huang, Modern Engineering for Design of Liquid Rocket Engines. The difference there is primarily units. Rocket Propulsion Elements is all metric. Huzel and Huang is all imperial units. Also, Huzel and Huang seems to have a little bit more specific guidance about, like, well, actually you should do experiments to figure out what this value is, but in lieu of doing experiments, here's like a table of suggested maybe start here values. So I think it's, if you can get through the unit hell that is the imperial unit system, I think it's maybe a little more directly applicable. It's also the basis for the scripts, which we can talk about in a moment. We have switch lock valve. I actually don't know what valve sizing this is for. Okay, here's general valve sizing. Okay, this is for general valve sizing from Swage Lock. And so this is what we can talk about more, I guess, during LFETs. Similarly, there's also a liquid fuel engine test stand, which we can talk about more tomorrow. Questions so far on where we've hidden things?
Nope.
Okay.
Actually, can you go back to the LFETs folder for just a minute?
Yeah.
Sorry, no.
Oh, up. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so we have the 2015, the 2018, and now the 2019 one.
Yes.
And now there's all the rest of all this crap on the outside here. But for your project and the current state of LFE and LFETs, that's all in that capstone folder. Is that correct?
Yes. To the best of my knowledge, it's all in here or it's on GitHub.
Right. Okay, good. Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. One of the things I might look into doing over the summer, maybe by a small committee, is try to go through some of the other outside folders and figure out what's in them.
That would be fantastic.
And maybe make something slightly more, I haven't exactly figured out. I don't know what the right structure here is and what would be most useful to someone trying to come into it and figure out what the heck is going on.
Just put everything in that archive folder.
Good plan. Yeah. The trick is to have multiple layers of archive nested within archive, I think.
Damn you all. So then let's plan on sometime this summer getting some of the people who are interested in working on this next year with you, and then we'll do an archaeological dig through this.
Yeah, we can go spelunking.
Yeah, good.
I guess the thing maybe, Saul, I don't know if you have it pulled up. I can give you a second and stall while you pull it up. Would you be willing to talk for a second about the like the scripts that we inherited, as well as maybe like the 30-second overview of CEA run? I feel like those are things that were not super clearly laid out to us and would be useful for folks moving forward.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I actually got a run through of it from, forgetting his name right now.
Maybe Corey.
Corey, who was doing a lot of the work with the MDO.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Did we cut that stuff out of our presentation video?
No. I think we left the scripts in. I think we cut CEA run because it wasn't super relevant to the Capstone project itself.
Right, I'm starting up.
Okay.
Let's see.
Here, let me.
So I already have the Python installed on my computer. So.
Well, you could. Here, if it would be better, I can just screen share because it'll open in the browser. It won't run, but it'll be viewable in the browser.
Ah, yeah. Well, the reason I was mentioning that is because I had to install that Python or Anaconda program on my other computer to work with it, and it took me a while to remember how to do that. So that would be a nice thing to have in a video, but.
Okay, sure. Here.
It's too long to figure out how to do it right now.
Okay, no problem. I'll.
One was able to figure it out. It's just a matter of going to the right website.
Okay, so I guess thing that would have been really cool to know, I think, earlier in the year for us was like, okay, how do you make a rocket engine? One of the best resources that was left to us by the 2015-2016 team was they essentially took all of the equations out of the like theoretical design chapter from the Modern Engineering for the Design of Liquid Rocket Engines, that book, which I think I'm just going to call Huzel and Huang from now on because the title is too long. So they basically sucked all of the useful theoretical calculations out of that book and converted it into a Python notebooks. Or Jupyter notebook script, which is now lives along with the rest of the, so this is the PSAS GitHub page. It now lives along in the Liquid Engine Analysis repo, which is also where the MDO is located. There are also archive versions of it actually located within the Liquid Propellant Engine repo, but Corey cleaned up a version last year and saved it under, I believe LFE design.
LFE design.
Yeah.
There it is.
Okay. Let me know, Saul, if you want to talk about this or if, because I'm stalling for you at the moment.
All right. I've got it pulled up on my browser.
Okay, here, I'm going to stop sharing, then I'll hand it off to you.
There you go. Everybody seeing this? This is the script we use to generate the internal geometry of the rocket. It's all good to read, and early in the winter, I went through it and checked it against the book, and I think they did a good job. The first half of it makes sense. A lot of it we ignored because we weren't doing regenerative cooling. But anyway, yeah, that's correct. That is the gravitational acceleration in imperial units. I'm not sure if Corey commented this, but
I think those are original comments.
Yeah. Anyway, whoever did it, I mean, mostly, probably mostly correct, right? So the CEA run stuff, yeah, molecular weight of your propellants. I wonder what that is, the molecular weight of. I think the fuel.
That's from CEA run. Yeah, that's going to be the exhaust gases.
Oh, the exhaust gases. Okay, so the combusted propellants.
Yeah, so I mean, what's cool about this is, and sorry, I don't, please jump in at any point, Saul, is that it lets you, I'm sorry, what?
You know it better than I do.
So I guess what's cool about this is it lets you play with all of your input parameters at the top. And then it sort of has all the calculations embedded in it. And then I'm currently actually could maybe demo this live. I assume this still has, does this actually have output geometry
yeah,
in this particular saved run?
When I open it, typically. Yeah, here's the nozzle.
That's okay, so let me actually, on my computer, I'm just starting a new instance of SolidWorks.
Internal contour.
Okay, so.
Are you gonna show?
Yeah, if you don't mind, I'll share back because this was kind of cool and I think would help accelerate sort of the next, help share the information more widely about how the magic works under the hood.
It could.
Okay, so.
Have you gone in and edited one of the parametric equations after generating it?
No, but I mean, so when you
can do that so that you don't have to remodel the whole thing.
Oh, that would be interesting. No, I've never tried that. However, we did try changing the input parameters as our, you know, the design parameter changed and then saw that the output curves changed as well.
Yeah. Huh. But I don't remember remodeling the whole engine. So you must have gone in and changed one of the equations in the sketch in SolidWorks.
All right. Well, I don't remember.
Figure that out.
Do you mind if I steal the screen?
Nope.
Okay. This is kind of going to be a trial. I don't know if this will work well, but okay. So here's the same notebook that we had open before. Again, what it lets you do is it lets you modify all your parameters.
See your video, but not your screen, Mark. I mean, I see your face.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. Shoot. I didn't hit. Damn it. You have to hit share twice. My bad. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Okay. So same script. Oh, that's weird. Okay. Newest version of Zoom. It highlights your screen while you're selecting which screen to share, and then it doesn't highlight your screen while it's actively sharing. Mm. Anyway, lets you change all your input parameters. We can talk about how you get the input parameters in a moment. But for right now, let's just assume you happen to know what your design mass flow rate is and your design exit pressure and the molecular weight of your exhaust gas and everything else. Another sort of back burner project that Corey and I had talked about a while back was all of the report in here is interesting and potentially useful, but I think if you want to read the report, it's generally not the same time as when you actually want to run the script. So maybe separating the like some of the math from some of the words might make it easier to find some of it. Or, yeah, I don't know. Yeah. It's
not too bad. It kind of
you kind of just, you're like, oh, okay, this section I don't read. And then you just scroll. And then you go, oh, nope, just keep scrolling. And then you just keep scrolling. And then you just keep scrolling. And then at some point you get down to parametric equations, right, which is actually what you want. So the way you make an engine shape initially is you put in all your input parameters up at the top, and then you start SolidWorks, and you, oh God, how am I going to do this?
I mean, I can do this as well.
Yeah, we saw it.
Okay. Well, no, but I need, okay, so then we start this and we go.
You start a sketch on the front plane.
Yeah, or whichever plane, okay.
No, the front plane.
Must be the front plane, I apologize. And then we go into our spline tool and we say, we say equation driven curve.
Yeah.
And now what we're going to do is we're going to go
parametric there.
Parametric curve. Oh, did I not select parametric? Oh, my bad. Sorry. Okay. You select parametric curve and then you say x of t equals t. And then you say for this one, y of t equals this. Mm-hmm. And then you say t1 is. And if there's anyone who actually knows exactly what's happening here, I know like 50% of what's happening, but I couldn't tell you, for instance, exactly why these are all of the t parameters. But anyway, you hit like that. Now you have a shape.
Yeah.
And then you repeat.
Yeah.
Oops. Equation driven curve, no. Parametric.
So with the very first time someone did this, they didn't get it centered perfectly on the axis. It wasn't actually perfectly symmetric, about the axis.
Yeah, and not all of the
bolt patterns. So when you're done with this, I'll show you something that might be able to make that not happen again.
Okay.
Go ahead and do it.
You want me to, there's like two more sections we can make it.
I know.
It's always dangerous to do CAD live.
Uh-huh.
It's like when you just
copy and paste that stuff and it works.
Yeah,
I've actually never seen this live. This is pretty great.
I don't think anyone's seen this live before. Literally, we were just like, "Are we missing something? Is there like something that we don't know? Like, how is this happening?" And then we were like, "Oh, it just works." Mm-hmm. Oh well, that was a silly thing to copy.
Consistency. Yeah, man, if you have two screens, I'll tell you this is lightning fast.
It is, but I'm only sharing one screen right now.
Oh yeah.
So
that wasn't a criticism of you, Mark. It was just a comment from the peanut gallery.
No worries.
Last one.
Oh my god. Okay.
So this is procedurally generated by all of the requirements up above. That's pretty great.
That's right.
It is. And then there's some other magic that's going on as well. And I got to be honest, I didn't, since this seemed to just work, I don't think we didn't invest the time in trying to figure out which parts of this are direct results of the equation and which parts are like prescribed conditions.
I checked the the design equations up at the top of the script, but I didn't check the math that actually generates these curves.
Okay, so what you get here is what do I want to do? Can I just revolve this, Saul?
No. Well, yes, you will. But first,
I need to thicken.
It's not the correct distance away from the origin, right?
Oh.
go back into the sketch. It might actually be. So just select all of that and fix it.
Good call.
Yeah. And then if you measure to the origin, you should have half of the throat diameter. Which is something like an inch. Yeah. 0.949
for there. Radius.
Yes, that's right.
That might be right.
The throat diameter. So I think that's right. All right, and then if you draw a little, you should go back in.
Oh, I need a center line. See, this is why you don't do. So you don't do CAD live.
Uh-huh.
That's okay.
Oh yeah, and you need to thicken it somehow.
Isn't that a command?
You can do that automatically, actually.
Yeah. Okay. Let's just see what happens if I. It's been a while since I tried doing this.
You can specify a thickness. So.
Okay. Great.
Leave it 0.1 inches. That's
sure.
Fine. I just have to say, Mark, you're very brave for cutting SolidWorks live on Zoom. Nice work.
Okay. So the problem here is that the points don't merge. This I remember doing this now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. There is a feature somewhere buried in SolidWorks, and it just requires Googling to identify which points of a curve don't merge. Okay. So this is not going to work right now. I don't remember.
You zoom way in.
Right. It's probably like maybe. Oh, yeah. There it goes. Or no, that's just a render error.
It gets weird when you zoom
in. Okay. So anyway, the concept here is now you go locate the point cleanup tool and try to merge the points that aren't previously merged. And then you can revolve it and make your engine bell. But if you imagine this revolved, that's sort of the basic shape based on whatever parameters happened to be in the notebook when it was run last.
And that's going to end up being the interior geometry?
This is the interior geometry, yes.
Right.
So just to ask a stupid question, the bottom part is the actual chamber and the upper is the nozzle, right?
Correct, yeah. So engine chamber goes down on the bottom. This is the bell.
Okay, good.
If we peek back and scroll... probably too quick to follow all the way up back to the top. We can see our exit pressure here is 43 kilopascals. So that's what, 0.4 atmospheres. So one of the reasons you get like a longer bell on this is because this particular design is optimized for less than atmospheric pressure.
Okay.
In terms of like what's actually coming directly out of the scripts and what's sort of black magic is I think if you read the section on the chamber design in the Huzel and Huang closely, it'll recommend like, I believe this is a circular section. And I believe this is a parabola. And so it'll say like, we recommend XYZ shape curve for like the rapid expansion. And then like, so there's some of that's been hard coded and some of that is taking outputs from the scripts. And I couldn't tell you which is which. I don't know.
It looks like a rocket anyway. I mean, an engine.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, that's good. So and then in that script, is there dimensions for the thrust chamber? And
no.
Okay.
That's actually was like a variable. That's a good question because that was a number that appears to be totally made up. conceptually, there's a balance where you want enough length. Ideally, your combustion chamber is infinitely long, so you get like perfect mixing. Right, like the longer it is, assuming you don't have heat loss, like assuming that it's perfectly insulated, which it's obviously not, like you want it to be longer for better mixing of the combustion, but you need it to be shorter than infinitely long because obviously there's a weight constraint and there's also going to be heat loss through the chamber, as well as I think probably for the engine though, mostly you just have more material that you're trying to cool if the chamber's bigger. So there's some trade-off there. Rocket Propulsion Elements hand waves at it and says most rocket engineers use test data for like how long should the chamber be. Huzel and Huang says that also, but then also says there used to be this number called L star. Which is the length to volume ratio, I think, if I'm not mistaken. I don't recall. Do you recall, Saul? I'm spacing out on the exact ratio it is.
Yeah, the ratio of the volume of the combustion chamber to the throat area. But what ends up happening eventually is you try to do your best and make something that's about the right size, and then you contact a 3D printer and they'll say, this needs to be a quarter inch shorter. And you go, well, all right, then we'll make it a quarter inch shorter. So it fits. And then you decide that it will probably still work.
Yeah, so I think what ideally you do if you had like a functioning test stand is you would take a best guess that something that, you know, achieves your weight targets while also seeming like a reasonable first guess, and then you test it. And based on the performance, you'd know whether it was, you know, it was performing as you expected or not, and then you could modify the chamber length.
That all makes a little bit of horrible sense. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, sorry. we haven't talked fuel injectors at all.
Well, let's go to the CAD, I think, next of LFE.
Okay.
I've almost got the engine thing working.
Oh no, are you working on fixing the...
Yeah, I mean, I feel pretty good. I think I could do it. Here, watch this.
Okay.
Everybody see it? So I just put in this curve here, and then you zoom way in. Now, this isn't the good way to do it, but it's the way I'm doing it right now. I'm just going to draw a line between those two points. It'll give us extra stupid geometry, but... might even be able to delete it later. And there's one more curve. Too many significant figures. That's our problem. Decimal places.
Yeah, I had wondered if some of these issues were self-imposed by not being whole numbers.
Oh, look at that. Why does it do that?
I don't know.
It's just see what happens.
It's probably the shape of the curve combined with something about how the endpoints are trying to drag it.
Yeah, if you try to drag the endpoints though, it doesn't necessarily work. So this isn't the good way to do it. There's some way where you can like fix the curve in space and still drag the endpoints around. So anyway,
I believe the tool I used a while back or tried to use was called Repair Sketch.
Ah, I ended up redrawing this thing at some point. I didn't do something exactly like that, but anyway. Yeah, whatever works makes it work.
Hey, that's a solid.
Yep. Oh yeah. There it is.
Nice.
Okay. Stop the video now.
You win the points. We're done. You're all set.
So let's go directly to what you guys currently have.
All right. This is the reason that the rocket, it's a bad habit, I've never broken. The engine CAD lives in the same repository as the test stand CAD now, is because we want to have the engine on the stand so we can route our tubing to it. And I just know that if you have the engine CAD in one repository and the test stand CAD in another one, that things will get messed up. So, right, in our video, I think there's a 6 or so minutes of me rambling about this. But we've got a lot of the valves clamped on Unistrut that somebody will have to screw in there. Some of the lengths of the Unistrut are obviously kind of wrong, like that's going to need to be shorter, but
Let's talk about LFETs tomorrow and just focus on the LFE today.
All right, let's do the LFE cap. Then back to the engine. Here it is. So the most recent quote unquote hybrid design. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. Idea here is that this combustion chamber will be turned and it could be stainless steel or something. So there's this one gasket that we'll have to make between the injector head and the combustion chamber. And I was going back looking through the quotes. Let's see. So this is the latest and last quote we got from i3D for the injector head. And I think, I didn't ask, but it might be the their regular rate, $5,000, because up here before, they originally quoted $9,900 for the whole engine in aluminum. And then Andrew, you talked to them and talked them into their 12-month rate. So it went down to $6,000. So it was about 61%. If you could get them to do that again, 61% of 5,000 is like 3,000. So
yeah,
it might make sense, but then you got to figure in the cost. Probably turning this thing, if you pay someone to do it, going to cost a couple $1,000. And if you try to do it at the machine shop, you'll have to buy tooling and spend on the material, and you could easily spend $1,000 doing that in-house. So then with the addition of your, you know, potential failure point of the gasket, it might be a toss-up whether it's better to just go back to printing the whole engine. And then let's see, I think that 3D Logix gave us a better quote for the whole engine. Well, yeah, seven grand for stainless steel, and stainless steel is definitely a better material choice if we can afford it. What else about this? So the pintle is just one piece of steel. I've got that round rod in my basement to bring back to the rocket room whenever school opens. So they have a locker to clean out, so they're supposed to give me access to do that, and then I would bring back that rod then. It's a three-quarter inch OD tubing running to the pintle. I think these are 3/8 NPT to half inch OD tubing adapters. And the idea here is that all this open space in here just gets, less dense infill, a lattice, when they're printing it. And nobody said that was a problem. There are as many bolts in there as we could fit, basically. Let's see, 12 bolts around.
So those little cutouts are for to get access to the test stand bolts, it looks like.
That's right, yeah. So that you can bolt it to the load cell. Yeah.
Okay.
Because yeah, otherwise you're I didn't think about it, but now I'm trying to remember why we didn't just bolt through there. I don't know. Maybe you didn't want more holes there, yeah. Not a hard time.
Maybe also so you don't have to take the engine apart to take it off the test stand.
Right, but you wouldn't have to take it apart to take it off.
Oh, I see. Just go long bolt all the way through.
Oh, you know, it was probably late at night. Who knows? Yeah.
Okay.
But what else to say about it?
Well, let me ask you questions, and then other people can ask dumb questions too.
That sounds good.
You've got a single, so this is, let's pretend for a minute, stainless steel, either 3D printed or roughed out.
Mm-hmm.
What's the O-ring made out of? Do we know?
Don't know. Don't have one. It's the same thing we talked about, midway through winter term.
Yep.
That ideally you want like a C, I was reading the Parker Seals O-ring, metal O-ring book, but.
Like a crush, a crush gasket or a crush
wire. A springy metal thing with like a C cross section in here, springs against it.
Yep.
But I never did try to get in contact with Parker, but I'm pretty sure that, you know, it cost a lot to order one of those, or even multiples, you know. I'm sure they have a big set fee. They've got they have a lot of flexibility in making those, but there are preferred dimensions. But
yeah, okay.
Then they're also, like you said, simpler would be laser cutting it out of just sheet, but the performance, you wouldn't expect it to be as good, but maybe good enough.
Okay. So then go back up to the injector part.
Mm-hmm.
And cut through for a second. There's three injectors up there. Okay. And then the inside guts of that are all just filled with powder and lattice structure and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, that makes sense.
This stuff, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And then,
because they can infill solid things, but then you wouldn't know if they would get these wall thicknesses right. Like we need this to be thicker than this over here.
Yeah.
Where we just print all that solid material.
And then the injector, the purple part there, that is a separately 3D printed thing.
This would just be turned. This is pretty easy to turn. Chuck it up in a lathe. Okay. Turn down the OD here and drill your hole. And so that's, I mean, once you got your tooling and your setup figured out, you crank one of those out in a day. So if you test the engine and it's not flowing quite the right ratios of propellants, then, you know, make another one of those. The rod that we got from Coast Aluminum, you can probably get 3 or 4 pintles out of it.
All right. So we chuck that up and make that ourselves, maybe, or have
maybe
shop make it for us.
Yeah. Yeah, you need a rotary indexer to drill these, and you,
right.
I think we ordered a few drills winter term, and some of them were stub drills to get these holes started, because you need to use a really short, rigid drill bit if you want to get the hole located in the right spot. But then changing the diameter of the hole is just a matter of buying a different dollar drill bit.
How big are those holes?
What does it say? These ones are 25 thou. Let's see, that's a...
I don't know if that actually reflects the final geometry. I think that may have... I don't know if we connected to update the SolidWorks after the simulations. Final simulations were... Oh, God. 1.18 millimeters, but I don't recall the inch number on that. Hold on. That is 0.0465, which was one of the small wire drill size numbers. It was like 56 or 57.
There it is. What is it?
0.0465.
A number 56.
That's not that big. Just having seen the drill bit, it's not that big.
It's not big, but it's not like ridiculous either.
Like, okay,
I was just curious because Aaron had talked about the potential of those hole sizes not being, I guess, clean, yeah, being how small they are and how that could affect the
pretty dramatically, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you want to drill? You want to drill like a little undersized hole in here, yeah, then drill these, and then come in with something to clean it up.
Yeah, okay.
A reamer or something. That's another tool you got to buy, but, you know, there's a way that you can get something in there to clean out these holes so that they don't have any burrs on their edges in here.
Yeah.
Important Mark found from his simulation notes.
How sharp the corner of the hole is makes a pretty large difference on the pressure drop.
Yeah.
At least according to the simulations. It seems like however exactly one goes about making this, it's going to be important to at a minimum water test the actual final product before you try to use it. Because I think even if you get two of them or three of them or 10 of them, they're all going to be slightly different, which is not ideal, but might just be a fact of trying to drill that many holes.
Yeah, it's definitely not, you know, outside of the realm of something that could be accomplished even at the PSU machine shop.
Great, thanks.
But you'd have to do it carefully.
Yes.
Okay, and then...
And then you'll need a gasket up here. Not a crush washer like they used, they had in the Pentel before. Those are not strong enough, but gaskets in this size range are easier to find available because it's ID. I think I found like a flat solid gasket on McMaster even for this. This ID is...
So
twice that.
Is this something that we should 3D print out of plastic and then water test then first?
The Pentel? We did that last term. And
yeah,
it's good to, yeah, taught us a lot.
I think it would be good to actually get the entire injector head assembly there printed as well. Might be a good candidate for, I know Jacob Tiller did some printing in multi-jet fusion last year, and that produced a pretty nice part.
Yeah, I've gotten some parts in that, and especially if you come in here and clean up like a few places where it matters, its surface is rough, but if you could just like finish this annulus here and then like do a little bit of hand sanding in there, you could probably get
in there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you all, when you guys research gaskets, is there a standard in the industry as far as, like, I know for the solid rocket motors on shuttle, they ended up switching to, I think, either two or three redundant gaskets. Have you guys come across any information on that?
Redundant gaskets, like one here and then like one out there. We don't really have room for that unless we make this, unless we make the OD or kind of the stock that you're starting with larger. And right now it's at 6 inches.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, cost goes way up if you go past that. I'll show you the thing I was looking at. I can find it again. It's somewhere in metal rings.
I just sort of at a super high level as well. I think gasket expertise is something that we lacked and could use some outside help on, to be perfectly honest.
And then did you guys think about, so your gasket location on the Pentel, did you guys think about having the gasket actually, I guess, on the annular part, I guess, between, trying to...
This gland here? Oh,
or actually, like down inside the engine between.
Oh, be better as if it was like a spark plug.
Yeah, something like that. I guess the only thing with this is if your screws start to back out, or like the pressure on the Pentel is going against your O-ring, right?
Mm.
Whereas if you had it actually like a spark plug, then you're not gonna. You're not going to loosen your seal until the whole thing pops out.
You're talking about having the gasket.
Yeah.
Here?
Yeah.
Well, that's an option. Yeah. I was thinking for machining the Pentel, for one, it would be actually easier to have this, this surface a bit thicker, and it'd be easier to machine that gasket gland into the injector head.
Yeah.
And you need to get a nice smooth surface on this injector head, no matter what. Let's see, in the Parker Seal O-ring book, you can get radial gaskets.
I think
like that.
Yeah.
Axial simplifications. But there's nothing you can, not, I mean, you could maybe sort of do something fancy like that down here, but like there's not actually that much space.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that's a really great question. I think we in some respects we also inherited that design from the previous one, which I think was intending to use a crush washer, for lack of a better word.
Yeah.
Like a large thin crush ring.
Right.
And that I think
I wouldn't recommend. They're not designed to handle all that much pressure. Here's another thing. If you do want to use like a radial seal here, you need to probably cut the gland, you know, the part that the seal rests in, into the pintle, and then get a really smooth finish here.
Yep.
Yeah. And it'd be a lot harder to cut the grooves in the injector head though.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
I suspect like exact gasket location, material, and manufacturing is going to be one of those details that seems like it's like a last 3%, and then you end up spending like half your time trying to figure out how to get it to work.
Yes.
So I'll leave something for the next.
Saul, will you show us, cut one of those fasteners in the pintle head in half and show us where that goes to?
Yeah. Are you talking about these fasteners?
Yeah. So we're tapping right into the okay.
Your ejector head, yeah.
Yeah, okay, good.
Yeah, otherwise you get a nut in there somehow.
Yeah. No,
hey,
that's
guys, I gotta I gotta sign off for another meeting. I'll talk to you guys tomorrow.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, I got to do the RFID.
All right, excellent.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Other questions? Since Saul's got the CAD open.
Yeah.
No one? All right.
Make sure that let's see. One thing, I did do it, but you got to make sure you leave enough meat there when it gets printed so you can actually tap your fittings into the material, because when SolidWorks models a NPT tapped hole, it actually models it without the material that the threads
are in.
So you see how you got to leave, you have to have an interference here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, does it not by default model it at the drill size? It models it actually at the finish size?
The drill size and then a kind of a different thing where it like models the tapered shape of the NPT thread without the thread.
Huh.
Yeah. I think
that's broken.
Sure about that, yeah.
That seems like not useful.
Yeah, but I mean, if you think about it, in most cases, you're usually making a drawing and it just calls out the NPT tap drill.
That's a fair point. Right, it's just a hole and it just has a label that says machinist make hole for this tap size.
Yeah, and you know what to do, you know, and they're not thinking necessarily about, 3D printing the things.
Yeah.
And then you need that material back there.
So yeah.
Watch this video, don't forget, or you'll be sorry.
So going to where we should probably have started in the very beginning, this current design is how many kilonewtons?
Yeah, I have it.
Six.
Right. And we put that in the script. Or no, we put that in CEA run.
Okay, good. So this is our 6 kilonewton design.
Yeah, you know, we probably should have started there. You're right. The inputs used in the Jupyter notebook are the outputs from the multiple design optimization that Corey ran as of October, November.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there actually isn't an input here for the thrust, because that basically, that flow rate of exhaust gas is what you get from CEA run when you get the thrust that you want.
So actually, Saul, if you can switch back to that screen for one moment to the Jupyter, the Jupyter notebook. That oxidizer to fuel ratio and the fuel mixture percentage, as well as it's not immediately, it slightly lowers pressure, are also design variables for which they all just sort of depend on each other, and they all sort of depend on things that you don't know until after you design the engine, but you need to know them before you design the engine.
And Mark, just sorry to derail you here.
No.
We did change this to atmospheric pressure to make our bell shorter, right?
Correct, for the test stand engine, yeah.
So this script that we're looking at is not the script that made the geometry that you're looking at here. Because this bell is shorter.
I think the only difference is the exit pressure, to be perfectly honest.
As far as we understand, all that has an effect on is the expansion ratio. So basically, in effect, the length of the bell.
Right. Okay. That makes sense.
It was to get it shorter so that it would be cheaper to print.
Do you know how many seconds we can fire this motor before it starts melting?
Depends on what you make it out of.
If you make it out of stainless steel, the simulations I ran predict melting after like 5 or 6 seconds. They're not perfect simulations. I'd be happy to talk through a little bit of that. You have errors in your file history drive. I'd be happy to talk through a little bit of what I did there. I don't know how long we want to make this meeting go for, but I can talk about some of the pluses and minuses in terms of simplifications and assumptions that went into that. But I would say if it's stainless steel and we shot for like 2 to 3 seconds, I think we'd be fine.
Yeah.
Fingers crossed.
If you're going to turn it, don't bother turning it out of aluminum.
Right.
Stainless steel.
Yeah, and the other thing that we didn't consider at all is, I guess, two things. Thing one is melting of the inside of the engine actually probably has a cooling effect as you're blowing chunks of metal out, or I guess liquefied metal out the end, maybe vaporized at that point. But that's going to have a cooling effect as well, although it probably makes the engine single use. The second thing we don't have any understanding of is how the pintle will behave inside the combustion chamber. One of the papers that I read long enough ago, I don't remember which one, talked about finding problems with the pintle melting in certain designs. So yeah, and that's, I think, something that we won't know until we try.
Pintle melting.
It's all on fire, man. I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, you hope not, because it's like locks on the inside, but it's hard to say without actually testing.
Right. Okay, good. So when we test fire this, one of the things we'll have to do is completely disassemble it and then find out what the hell happened on the inside.
Yes, that's probably going to be almost more important than the test firing, is taking it apart and looking at
what
failed and what survived.
Yeah.
Assuming it doesn't take itself apart for us.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
Find it after you test fire.
Then the slight modification is before you can look at the engine, you have to find it.
Yeah. All right, everybody, spread out.
All right, great. I don't think we need to go over the heating stuff, because that's in the report.
It is in the report, correct.
In the video, yeah.
Then I think, unless anybody else has questions, this is a great overview. Thank you, guys. Nice work on this.
We could, I guess, we should take some questions, then maybe we could talk a little bit about, like, maybe recommendations or whatnot. I don't know. We could do that tomorrow as well, either way.
Well, if you have recommendations about the engine, we should do that today.
I guess, like, sort of
don't
super
start over.
Yeah. That you want to talk about that, Jake?
Yeah, it's just too much for any one team to get done in the short amount of time frame there's too many aspects that all need to be experimentally tested to verify. So if you start over, you don't really have a source that you can go pick and choose hard facts to design off of. And that's one of the big issues that we had making hard decisions about the way we design stuff is a lot of things like the chamber length are all experimental and they are all varied based off of how your engine is built. So I would say to ward against any redesign, put together what we came up with, even if it's not ideal or even 100% functional.
Hey, Pratik, can you mute yourself, please?
Your results from the test fire and then make an engineering analysis of what happened and what should take place, because a lot of it's just shooting in the dark for what you're trying to accomplish until you can get some physical data off of your design.
Yeah, I'd second that.
It might not be perfect, but that's what I think should happen next before any more redesign happens, because we got ourselves into a place that we could just keep redesigning and redesigning for small improvements and efficiencies and research like gaskets. You could go a full capstone into just researching what and how to use the most optimal design for a gasket system for each and every one of these interfacing parts.
If you print the engine, you have to worry about one less big gasket.
Yeah.
And also you got enough degrees of freedom to fine tune your pintle. You can change, your hole sizes, change this inside thing. And you can also turn down the outer diameter of it to give yourself a different, annulus area. So, assuming the combustion chamber and nozzle geometry works, and we have, reason to believe that it will, printing one engine doesn't lock you into the pintle geometry in any way.
Yeah, I gotta tell you, the only reason I don't want to print the engine, which I actually really do want to print it, is that we can't open it up and see what the hell is going on the inside.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
You would expect and hope that even if the combustion chamber and nozzle end up being single use, you ought to be able to get more than one use out of the injector head.
And you would hopefully.
Right. With this, when you have a gasket, you can open it up and you can see inside. So that's a good consideration.
Yeah. I think a lot of credit goes to Saul for the design of the fuel inlet channels. All of those, I believe, should conform to the maximum overhang angles of the printers. So it should all be printable.
The reason that they're funny shaped and not circular is that, the printer will do better printing these angles that come to just a small radius up here. And we do have an FDM print. The filament, plastic print, although not really the same as a metal 3D printer. It at least printed and it seems okay.
I guess sort of also on the recommendations, sort of to second what Jacob said, I totally agree with not doing another redesign without at minimum building or printing something and doing some testing. I think that was...
Yeah.
I think it took us too long. I think there's a long startup period that we hadn't really accounted for in the project, where it just takes a few months to learn enough to know how much you don't know. Mm-hmm. And so by the time we sort of got through that and had done some design work and had refined it to the point where it was like a thing that could be made, it was pretty late in the process.
Yeah.
And I think had we started with something, had we started with the the last year's design and just said, let's just make last year's design and do a bunch of testing, I think we maybe would have learned more about its actual performance.
I feel like you could easily spend an entire year just proving all of the things that are combined from all the research that all the capstones have done to this point. Like, you could go back and spend an entire year just trying to find out why each of the decisions that we made are decisions that we made. And each of those decisions comes with its own extensive research and dead ends that can't be accounted for. And you go getting yourself into the weeds for days at a time. And you start to realize what a limited time frame you're on when you spend a week chasing a dead end. And then you've got 30 other aspects you need to go deep into research on.
Yeah, I think we also hadn't expected. Oh, I'm sorry, Jake, go ahead.
No, I'm done.
Okay, I was just going to add that I also think we hadn't really thought about the overhead of the capstone class as well. That in looking at the project at the beginning of the year, all we saw was this like wide expanse of number of months to work on this. And there was significant effort that went into doing the reports, doing the presentations. You don't actually have a full year, right? Like you have less than that because of the time required to learn the material, like to learn the background, which is, it's fine. It's all part of the process, but I think it's just something that we didn't know at the beginning, was like learning the material and also like takes a lot of time actually to do the like reports and presentations and other capstone assignments.
Yeah.
That's great. Okay.
Check this out. If anybody ever watches this video again, look, it's got a big 5,000 PSI number. Maybe this is the thing to do with the pintle. Okay. Sorry for the interruption.
So the state of the engine right now, theoretically speaking, we could take your CAD and we could make it. And the only thing that's not really 100% on this CAD are the seals. Is that true?
The seals are not 100%.
I would say that the seals are the things that are furthest from 100%.
Okay.
You can probably get one of these multi-jet fusion printed for a few hundred bucks.
Yeah.
And then turn this. And then you'd be able to figure out, you'd be able to learn about your...
You could
flow.
Yep.
Yeah, I think you could even make the pintle out of metal and make the injector head out of plastic, and bolt those together and try that with water. I think seals are the furthest, like Saul said. I'm certain there's something else that we missed that we just don't know. So I think in terms of engine, like whatever the lowest cost way to get it actually like something that can we start to like assemble and test is probably going to be the next best step there. I think maybe the 3D printing route for at minimum the pintle and the rest of the injector head would be a good next step. To be able to actually like put it together, try to collect data, see how the different, like, can you put a gasket up there? Does that work? Like, what are the other challenges? I think we'd learn more from doing that than from any sort of redesign.
Yeah.
It would also enable other capstone teams to work on their processes and systems as well. SAR could get some data and find out what systems they have designed flawlessly and what errors they may have not accounted for.
The other thing that collecting actual data would be really helpful for is also going to be calibrating CFD models. I realize I didn't know enough at the time to ask. I could probably still ask Jacob Tiller, but some of his early stuff that he shared said like we tried CFD and like the numbers from the CFD didn't match the experimental flow data. And I realized I never actually asked him like why he thought that occurred. But like for the flow we did, one of the things I was able to do was look at the flow results that we got. We actually got through the plastic pintle, which is not exactly the same as it will be in metal, but plastic versus the simulations were like 30 or 40% different initially.
Yeah. Okay.
And it turned out the difference there was because the CFD was modeling a perfectly sharp hole, whereas the plastic itself had a very small radius on it. So just adding the tiniest of radius to the inside of the holes, for example, brought the pressure simulations much closer in line. So I guess my point there is calibration of your simulations is another huge benefit of getting actual experimental data.
Like the load cell, we had the same exact thing where experimentally we found out it worked a little bit different than the theoretical model with FEA and everything.
Thank you, Sal. I'm glad you're putting that in there. Okay, we should wrap this up. It is 11:22 and we had an hour and a half for this. And I think that we've beaten this to death with a dead horse. Any last stuff from anybody? All right.
How much time? I wanted to ask, how much time do you think this takes? Because since you have already worked on it, you mentioned that working on the previous design is actually better than researching on a new one and trying to optimize that. So if you would, is it possible for you to comment on the time, how much each of the things would take?
I think this is nothing that the application of a few thousand or tens of thousands of hours couldn't solve. No. So I guess it depends. There's a lot of dependencies in exactly how much time it's going to take. I think to go from here to the point where, to go from here to, for instance, ordering like multi-jet fusion prints of for example, multi-jet fusion prints is not a ton of time. That's something you can just like order them online from Shapeways if you really wanted. How you do testing there is gonna take some amount of time as well, but that's on the order of probably like less than 100 hours of testing.
100 hours for testing.
Maybe cumulative between a few people. To then go from there to solving the design, to solving problems, adjusting the design. I'm not sure I can give you a real estimate.
Okay. For testing, it generally takes, I mean, approximately, it should go about 100 hours, right?
It's kind of maybe a conservative guess. I don't know.
Okay, cool.
At this point, Pratik, I think we just don't know. And we won't know until we actually do it, which is one of the problems about doing this new sort of technology thing where you're constantly teaching yourself what the hell you're doing in the first place. It's not knowable. There you go. I want to go ahead and cut the recording and say okay. Thank you guys. Good job. Hang on afterwards for just a minute.
Yeah, sure.
But I wanted to congratulate you on getting actually a surprising amount done on this and kind of bringing everything to a place where I feel we could start actually building if we had money and less viruses around. So nice job, guys, and look forward to other people watching this and spooling up quicker than you guys did because you did a lot of archaeology.
Cool. Well, thanks.